just anoint me, anoint everyone in this room. Anoint them with ears to hear and hearts to receive, and minds to understand and a will to apply what your word instructs. Now, Father, let revelation knowledge flow. Share your heart, reveal your mind in any way you bless us. We will be satisfied. Now, Father, we know that you're here and we acknowledge your presence. And we say, have your way in this place. Move any way you want to move. Do what you want to do. Say what you want to say. It is in Jesus' name we pray and we boldly declare the devil is defeated. God, you are exalted. And Jesus, you are Lord. And all who agreed with the prayer of the man of God shouted hallelujah. Amen. And thank you, Jesus. Before you're seated, I really want to call your attention again to verse number 27. But remember now that Israel has come out of the Red Sea. They've been journeying for about 8 years to maybe eight months to a year and 3 months, maybe a year and a half. They've been on this long journey coming out of Egypt, coming through the Red Sea, and they finally get out. The Bible lets us know that when they come out, they've been thirsty 3 days, and when they finally come to a body of water, they can't drink it. The Bible calls that place Marah. The word Marah means bitter. For water to be bitter means it is contaminated. It means that it is dangerous. It means that it is filthy. It means that it is a health hazard. But what God does is he speaks to Moses and says, Moses, I need you to throw a stick into the water. The Bible says that he throws the stick into the water, and we know that the stick comes from a tree. The word tree literally means Torah or the word of God. He throws the word of God into a potentially poisonous situation, and the waters go from being bitter to sweet, or undrinkable to drinkable. After they have that experience, the Bible says, LJ, that God speaks to Israel, says to Israel, y'all, listen, I'm testing y'all right now for your future. Because in the future, I'm going to say some things to you. I'm going to give you instruction. And if you do what I tell you to do, you will experience, watch this, a life that is unlike the life of the Egyptians. Because I made the Egyptians sick. And if you get sick, it won't be because I made you sick. Y'all follow me? I'm the one who heals you, makes you whole, makes you well. After they have that conversation, the text says they move. Somebody shout, they move. Say it again, they move. All right, so in verse number 27, the Bible says that they moved, or they came to a place called Elim, where there were 12 wells of water and 70 palm trees. So they camped there by the waters. Tell somebody, don't get stuck where you are. Move. You may be seated. Don't get stuck where you are. Don't stay there. Move. Good morning, family. My brothers and my sisters, at the outset of this message, I want to suggest to all of us that there is no one who has ever gone through life, who is presently going through life, or who will go through life without having bad experiences. As a matter of fact, Cynthia Glenn, bad experiences are built into the prophetic portfolio of our earthly existence. We have a divine guarantee from God himself that we will encounter discomfort, darkness, and disappointment along the way. The Bible is bountiful with warnings concerning the phenomenon of relationships. I could put a pin right there, but I don't want to stay at this point. Because if you want to be used by God, the first thing that God is going to do is he's going to open your eyes and help you to understand that to be asked to be used by him is to be asking for trouble. Because it is trouble that qualifies you to be used by God on whatever level he uses you. You want to be used? Expect trouble. You want God to get glory out of your life? Expect trouble. You want to reign with him? Expect to suffer with him. Not only does Jesus say this to us in John 16, not only does he say it to Ananias in Acts chapter number 9, but in Exodus, the book of our text, Exodus chapter number 4, God tells Moses, watch this, that you're going to have to deal with a difficult Pharaoh who will be an obstinate opponent to your assignment and your purpose. Watch this, because God says, I hardened his heart. I have made his heart hardened against you. So the difficulty that you will experience does not find its origin in the devil. The difficulty that you will experience, God says, I have orchestrated it and built it into your life so that when you deal with difficulties, you must understand that just because it's hard, it doesn't mean that it ain't God. Just because you are dealing with resistance, just because you are dealing with opposition, just because you are dealing with something that is in counter-distinction to your progress, don't ever think that the devil has enough power to put in your way something that can stop you if God is with you, in you, and working through you. So that if you are experiencing resistance, it ain't the devil who originated it. It is God, watch this, who purposed the resistance so that you can develop the strength necessary to move to your next level. Oh, God, I'm going to preach whether y'all want me to or not. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying in here? So God says, I have built into your life these problems. I've built into your life these bad experiences so that I can work something in your life that is going to be of great value in the future. I think that I've done a pretty good job, Mo, of making the case that bad experiences are unavoidable. And since that is the truth, we must understand that the purpose of confrontations with God-ordained bad experiences is to give us a revelation of God's grace. Somebody ought to shout grace. Grace. Or of his ability to sustain us in seasons of our process that are designed to prepare us for our better life. So that when you are meeting resistance that God has ordained that you meet, God says, I want to open your eyes to the concept of grace. Y'all miss what I said. If you are dealing with something, some confrontation, some problem, some issue that seems to be keeping you from moving ahead, God said, I'm trying to show you that I have the ability to sustain you in your season of your process that is designed to prepare you for the better life that I have designed you for. I have to then get a revelation of grace because grace is God's strength being made perfect in my weakness. Grace shows to me that God will allow me to use his power on my behalf so that I can do something that I could not do in my own strength. Grace says to me that if I am in situations that have the power to drive me crazy, I don't have to go crazy because I am not depending on my own strength to keep myself sane. I am not depending on my own mind to give me direction. I have the mind of Christ.
visualize. I'm able to conceptualize. I'm able to process, watch this, on a higher level than my past experiences. In other words, with the grace of God, I begin to figure things out that I ain't never studied as to how to get the answer. And I have the grace of God. God gives me answers in the midst of the craziest time of my life, so that when I'm going through something, I don't know how I got what I got, but I do know that God gave it to me. All right, the old folk would say it this way: my soul looks back and wonders how I got. Oh God, I've got a church in here today. Is there anybody in here who has looked back over your life and know that when you were going through what you were going through, God gave you a revelation of grace? Is there anybody besides me who can look back over your experiences and say, I don't know how I got out of that. I don't know how I came through that. I don't know how God fixed that. But I do know that I came out, and I came out better than I was when I went in. Am I talking to anybody in here who can give God praise for his grace?
The recipient of God's grace, God gives me strength in areas that I am weak, so that I might be able to bear the weight and the fire of the process while I'm in it. Grace makes things bearable, but I came to let somebody know that the bearable life is not the ultimate end of God. In other words, God does not just want you to go through life being or having the ability to bear stuff. Bearable ain't it. God does not want you to live the bearable life. God wants you to live the blessed life. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord. Thoughts to prosper you, to give you peace, not to harm you, to give you a future and a hope. God said the life that I've designed for you is not a life where you spend your time adjusting so that you can bear situations and deal with circumstances that are beneath my plan for your life. I just gave you grace to bear it, to prepare you for where I'm taking you next. I don't know who I'm preaching to in here today, but Jesus says, I came that you might have life, but he didn't stop there, that you would have it more abundantly. Translation, I'm not just the God who will give you the ability to bear what you're going through, but I am the God that will give you the ability to bear it till I bring you through it, and I can bring you to a blessed place. Who am I talking to in here? Grab your neighbor, say, neighbor, God has given me grace so I could bear everything I went through. But the only reason that he helped me to deal with that is because he got something better on the other side of what I'm going through now. Touch your neighbor, say, neighbor, God got something better than what you're going through right now. And don't you dare get stuck with bearable, because God wants to push you to a place of being blessed. Somebody shout, yes, Lord. I'm almost done.
not the end of it. The Apostle Paul, can I call Paul to help me with the message? Paul, help me to teach the lesson, because Paul says that God, watch this, will not allow you to go through anything that you can't handle. For God will not allow you to be tempted above that which you are able, but he is faithful that with the temptation, he will provide for you a way to escape that you might be able to bear it. So that the purpose of the grace of God is to help you to endure the process of perfection and maturation. So that, watch this, he can bring you through the process. Touch your neighbor, say, he's bringing me through it. Touch one more neighbor, say, he's bringing me through it. So ain't no need of me getting bitter in the midst of the process, because wherever I am and however I'm feeling, I'm still surviving, and I am surviving by the grace of God. Whatever has happened, you will have to admit that your testimony was it hurt, but you still surviving. That you might be lonely, but you're still here. That it might be uncomfortable, but you're still alive. Who am I talking to in here today that has the testimony that the only reason you're able to go through what you're going through now is God's grace? And God's grace just says to me that I got better for you in the days to come. Somebody ought to shout, yes, Lord.
Careful, I'm almost done. If we are not careful, Pam Hamilton, we will get stuck at a place of accepting that which is manageable and become satisfied with the manageable as being as good as it can get. Let me say that again. If you are not careful, if I am not careful, if we are not careful, we can get stuck at bearable and think that bearable is as good as it gets. We spend our lives adjusting so that we can get comfortable with things that are uncomfortable. And pretty soon, if you accept your situation is as good as it gets, you lose focus of the fact that God did not bring you this far to leave you. Where am I getting this from? I'm getting it from the text. And I'm almost done. Touch your neighbor and say, he's almost done. You ain't lying. I'm almost done. Watch what happens. God brings Israel out of the Red Sea to the place called Marah. Marah is in the land of Shur. Remember, Shur means wall. Marah means bitter. They get to the place in Shur, or they've hit the wall, and they are weak because of dehydration. Somebody notices that the water is contaminated. They get mad and start tripping on Moses. Moses cries out to God and says, God, the water is bitter. God says, Moses, take a stick, throw it into the water, and watch this. Bitter water becomes sweet. Or contaminated water become clean. Or undrinkable water become drinkable. The text would have us to know by way of inference that they drank the water that had been made sweet or drinkable by the stick that Moses threw in the water. All right, I'm going somewhere. Y'all please follow me. They are able now to hydrate themselves or to get strength from a temporary source of hydration. Y'all missing this.
The water was bitter. God made it sweet for them so that they could drink it. But they drank it, watch this, not to stay at that place. I'm preaching to somebody in here. One of the things that you got to learn how to do is you have to learn how to interpret how God works in your season or in your life while you are in the process of getting prepared for your next. And God will do some things for you in your wilderness season just to show you that he's God. But what he does not want you to do is get stuck at the last thing he did. I wish you would touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, don't you dare get stuck where you are right now. Because what God did for you yesterday was just God sustaining you for what he's going to do for you tomorrow. Am I preaching to anybody in here who could take this mic and say the worst thing I could have ever done was settled for what was bearable in my life? The worst thing that I could have ever done was stayed in a place that God was using to sustain me, but not to bless me. The worst thing I could have done was to stay stuck in a way that God was just giving me enough to make it by, but not understand that he is the God who will do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that I could ever ask or think. I wish you would touch one more neighbor and say, neighbor, don't get stuck there, because better is on the way. Don't get stuck there, because more is coming to you. Don't get stuck there, because God has something that's going to blow your mind on the other side of the process. Shout yes, Lord.
Troy, watch this, son. I love it. They drink the water at Marah. But notice what the text says. They drink the water, watch this, of temporary sustenance. But they got sense enough to know that you can't stay at a temporary place. How do I know? Because the text uses the transitional word, then. Then they came, Mike, to Elam. Somebody shout, then. Then they came to a place that was different from the place that they left. Somebody shout, then. Then they moved from a place where God made the water drinkable, made the situation bearable, made the circumstance inhabitable. I came to preach to about five of y'all today. If I see the five, I'm gonna hurry up and finish it. Whoever you are, jump up on your feet once I make this statement. I need somebody to understand that God will never give you an if unless he gives you a then. Y'all miss what I said. God will never put you in iffy situations if he's not going to give you a then outcome. Y'all miss what I said. Let me see. You got it, son. I said, if God allows you to deal with some iffy stuff, some uncertain situation, all you got to do is trust him. And if you trust him, your if is going to turn into a then. All right. If you will call on me, then I will answer you. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, then you will be saved. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear. Oh, touch your neighbor, say, neighbor, I'm dealing with an iffy situation. And the only reason I'm dealing with it is because I'm getting ready to go to my then. After this, then I'm going to be blessed. After this, then I'm going to have peace. After this, then I'm going to have favor. After this, then I'm going to be stronger. After this, then I'm going to be wiser. After this, then I'm going to have everything that God promised me. Shout yes, Lord.
From the bitter waters made sweet to sweet waters that won't ever be made bitter. So then, somebody shout then. Then they moved to Eden. I told y'all last week, that the word Elam means strength.
Sustains them in a temporary place. He moves them from weakness that he miraculously sustains them in to a place of strength, because Elam means strength. You have to be careful not to get stuck in the place of your past weaknesses. Your past and the negativity of the same, that you miss the strength that you got from the process. Okay, let me see if I can fix that. See, here's the problem with many of us. We stay stuck at what happened yesterday. And my testimony is this. Praising God for what he did in my yesterday, that I'm not able to embrace the fact that if God did that yesterday, what more would he be able to do today and tomorrow? I'm preaching to about 13 of y'all who act like you don't know what I'm talking about. Because the reason you have not been able to move forward is because you're living on yesterday's testimony. You got a glory day's praise. You are praising God for your yesterday. But can I help you to understand that praise is always prophetic? Y'all missed what I said. I said your praise is always prophetic. And prophetic is always projective. Y'all miss what I said. So that whenever I'm prophesying, I'm projecting something that's going to happen in the future. So I'm not just praising God for my yesterday. I'm praising God because my yesterday is a point of reference for my tomorrow. I'm praising God because what he did the last time encouraged me to know that he's still God. And if he's the God of my yesterday, he's the God of my today. And if he's the God of my today, he is the God of my tomorrow. So how is it that you can be going through everything you're going through and still have a smile on your face. Well, I'm smiling today because God sustained me yesterday. And I'm smiling today because God is always going to one-up himself. Y'all miss what I said. God is in the business, I'm almost done, of outdoing himself. God is in the business of showing you that there is nothing too hard for him. God is in the business of showing you that if you just trust him and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. I wish you'd touch your neighbor, don't lie, but touch your neighbor, say, neighbor, I've spent enough time praising God for what he has done. I'm going to spend the rest of my life praising God for what he's going to do. Who am I talking to in here who has a prophetic praise? I'm going to give you about 15 seconds to praise God. Watch this. For what he's doing in your today and what he's going to do in your tomorrow. On the count of three, praise him for the future that you know he has in store. One, two, three. Come on. I'm almost done. Tell your neighbor, I will not get stuck in yesterday or today. I will not get stuck in the past or the present. I'm living in the present, but I'm living for the future. And the last time I checked, my future looks a whole lot better than my past and my present. Shout yes, Lord.
Be seated. So they are, I'm almost done. They have moved from Shur and the waters of Marah, where God, watch this, has made the waters bearable. And now they're moving to Elam, where the text says, somebody shout, the text says, where the text says that when they get there, there are 12 pools of water waiting for them to get there. Okay, I thought I was talking to Temple Church International. And not only are there 12 pools of water, but there are 70. Done. Here is what blows my mind in this text. Because remember, they are in the wilderness. What makes a wilderness is the lack of water and vegetation. An oasis that they don't know that exists until they get there. You got it, son? Let me say this again, because more than one person should have got this. When they were stuck at the bitter waters of Marah, remember, this was their first time ever being there. They have not been there before, which would suggest that they haven't been to the next place either. But when they leave the bitter waters, after God jacks them up for complaining, almost done. It's already prepared for you. But if you are stuck where you are, complaining about what you don't have, forgetting how good God has been to you by giving you grace to sustain you in your bad season, it means you ain't ready for your next season. I wish you would touch your neighbor, say, neighbor, the reason I don't stop complaining is because I realize that if God could sustain me in the worst season of my life, he can usher me into a better season than I'm experiencing now. Who am I preaching to who's made up in your mind that you'll never complain another day in your life, but in faith, you're going to move to what God has prepared for you. And can I tell you that what God has prepared, eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, it hadn't been entered into the hearts of man. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, I got an idea of what God has for me next. I just don't know all the details. I don't know how many blessings are in my next season. I just know that I got blessings coming down the road. I don't know how much favor is waiting for me in my next season. I just know that I got enough favor to turn my whole situation around. Somebody shout, yes, Lord. Be bitter again. And some of you have been stuck at a place where God was sustaining you, and because you thought it was good as it would get, the thing that used to make you laugh is now making you cry. The thing that used to give you joy is now giving you sorrow. And it just might be that your season for the temporary is up. And it's time for you to move into the season of the eternal. I don't know who I'm preaching to in here, but you can wave at me and tell me to go ahead and preach. Because what God will do is he will put hell on a situation to move you to the heavenly blessing that he has in your future. Some of y'all in here crying about a situation that God got you out of. God says that season is up. And I had to make you so uncomfortable in that season because it was over to get you to move in faith into your next season. Come here, Abraham. Where you going? I don't know, but I'm following God because I know that if I follow God, what I'm leaving gotta be nowhere comparing to where I'm on my way to. I wish I had somebody in here to give God 15 seconds of praise, because you don't know where you're going, but where you're going is better than where you are right now. Help me preach this message. Tell somebody, say, neighbor, the reason I'm praying and praising God and giving him glory is not because I know where I'm going. I just know that where I'm going is better than where I am right now. Shout, yes, Lord. I'm in this one verse. their next place because they realize that you can't make something temporary permanent. Of God's grace just means that he's keeping you so that the process does not destroy you, but he is not keeping you so you can perpetually stay in a process after its season is over. Because they realized that, they moved to a prepared place. I said to you, don't get stuck where you are. I said to you, Nikki, don't get stuck with bearable when God has blessed in store for you. And three things I want to share with y'all, and I'm getting out of here. How do you navigate your way from bearable to blessed? Number one, you have to appreciate the authority of God in every situation. Somebody say appreciate the authority of God in every situation. All right, here it is. Watch this little gentleman. Here it is. They leave sure. Is symbolic of the authority of God. Water is symbolic of the Spirit of God. There are 12 pools of water. 12 reminders of the power is that this ain't water in Canaan. This is water in the wilderness. Some of you get stuck in what's barren because you don't understand to sustain you in a wilderness environment. You got it, son. God is the God of the promised land. And he's the God of Egypt. But he's also the God of the wilderness. He's the God of the beginning. He's the God of the end, but he's also the God of the in-between. And many of us don't want to move from where we are because we forget that God has the authority, even in your wilderness seasons, to sustain you, watch this, and to give you promised land conditions while you in the wilderness. All right, all right, all right. Okay. Maybe this went over your head. Or maybe you just ain't with it, so I need to explain it a little more. Some of y'all are in a wilderness right now, but you're experiencing promised land conditions. Some of y'all ain't getting paid what you're worth on your job. you still paying your bills. I'm going to talk whether you want me to or not. Some of y'all, watch this, ain't getting the money that you want, but you ain't missed a meal unless you decided to fast. Who am I talking to in here? Some of y'all are in a season of loneliness. You are lonely, but you ain't alone. God, I'm going to talk to you because you got God with you. And you have made up in your mind that if I ain't got nobody else, I'm the best company I can have. So me and God, watch this, gonna enjoy where I am right now until God takes me to my next place. Who am I talking to in here that has the testimony that God is the authority in every situation? As a matter of fact, the reason the devil hadn't taken me out is because God is the authority in my life. So that when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord raises up a standard against him. Touch your neighbor, say, neighbor, I'm under the authority of God. And because I'm under the authority of God, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Because I'm under the authority of God, the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, they may come upon me to eat up my flesh, but because I'm under God's authority, they will stumble and fall. Because I'm under the authority of God, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall provide under the shadow of the Almighty. Tell somebody, I appreciate God's authority. That I can put you in the midst of a chaotic situation and you still have peace that you don't even understand. I'm so big of a God that I can show you that I don't need for you to have a job for me to meet your needs. Tell somebody in here, I appreciate God's authority.
If you're not going to get stuck where you are, you got to appreciate the authority of God in every situation. Number two, you have to conceive in your mind the concept, watch this, of the complete sufficiency of God. Let me say it again. Conceive in your mind the concept of the complete sufficiency of God. Where I get it from? It's in the text. Tell your neighbor, it's in the text. Israel. I said 12.
death. We're in the wilderness. If Elam, I said 12. He just told me to tell you.
Oh, God, have mercy. Christina, you might want to give somebody the baby because you're going to shout about that.
He just told me to tell us, Mama Judy, that for everybody in here, whatever your family going through, I got a well in the wilderness for every family. I wish you would grab your neighbor and say, neighbor, you can go ahead and start praising now, because there's a well, there's a pool in the midst of your crazy situation for everybody in your crazy family. If you believe me, lift your hands and shout, yes, Lord. There's deliverance for every bound person in your family. There's salvation for every lost person in your family. There's healing for every sick person in your family. Shout, yes, Lord. Are there 12 wells, but there are 70 palm trees. I'm going to close the lesson here. The palm tree is symbolic of the strength of God. But the number 70 is a very interesting number. To dehydrate is because of direct exposure to sunlight. So I gotta lead you to a place that not only will I be able to strengthen you, but protect you so that whatever you go through won't have the power to weaken you ever again. Oh God, who am I preaching to in here? I'm talking to somebody who needs to grab this. God say, I'm not just going to give you water. I'm going to give you shade. Not like the shade your enemies give you, but the shade I'm going to give you is going to protect you from the heat, so that even though you're in the wilderness, I'm going to make it seem like you're walking in the promise. I wish you would touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, I've made up in my mind that I won't complain about where I am, because I found out that where I am is good as it gets right now. It's going to be better in the future, but I got it good as it gets right now, because all I need where I am now is God. Everything and everybody else is extra. But if I lose everything and everybody walks away, as long as I got God, touch your neighbor, say, neighbor, I got enough. Can I ask you a question? How can you lose everything and have God? Y'all miss what I said. How can you lose everything and have God? It ain't possible. Because if you got God, you got who owns everything. And if God owns everything, whatever I lose, he'll give it back to me. Touch your neighbor, say, neighbor, I got God. And the last time I checked, he is.
is the possessor of heaven and earth. I got God. And the last time I checked, he is Jehovah Rapha, the God that heals me. I don't need insurance as long as I got the healer. Somebody shout, yes, Lord.